Greetings, friends. This is Survival Doc. If you're one of my regular YouTube video watchers, you may have noticed that for a period of time there, I sort of disappeared. Well, there are a couple of reasons for that. One of the most important reasons being is that now I have officially bugged out. As you may know, I lived the last 25 years in St. Louis County. I've been wanting to bug out for a while. I wanted to move out into more rural community where I could be more self-sufficient. And we finally decided to make that move, especially here now that we feel like we are really coming down to the end of the world as we know it. And we believe that this economic collapse that we've been predicting for years is now upon us. I believe it has actually already started. I think it's going to roll slowly here for a little while. Eventually it's going to reach a point like the snowball rolling down the hill. It's going to reach the point where it's going to gather a lot of speed and a lot of momentum, and it's going to catch a lot of people by surprise. Well, we sold our house in St. Louis County. We've moved out here into the country, bought 5 acres of wooded property surrounded by more wooded areas. The town that we're closest to is a little unincorporated town, has one store in it. We live on a gravel road. It's a dead end gravel road. We do have other neighbors who live on that gravel road, and we're in the process right now of getting to know these neighbors. I've actually started a preppers group out here because I believe that when the crap hits the fan, one of the most important things, one of the most important assets we're going to have is our network or the people that we know. I don't think the lone wolves are going to have a very good chance. I think the people who are going to have the best chance are the people who surround themselves with a good network of like-minded people. People who love freedom, who love liberty, who believe in the Constitution, the Bill of Rights, and people who are self-sufficient. Out here in the country, people are just naturally self-sufficient to a large extent, at least compared to people in the city. All of our neighbors have large wooded lots. Most people heat with wood. There is so much wood out here. If you look around, you may notice there are downed trees out here. We didn't even have to cut trees down for wood. I've got enough wood on my property just from downed trees that have fallen down from storms and things like that. I can come out here and cut up and split wood and have enough wood to heat my house for a few years without even cutting down any trees. I've already planted a lot of fruit trees. I've tilled up my garden. I'm building a greenhouse. I'm working on an aquaponics unit, and we are doing everything that we can to become more self-sufficient. I've put up my ham radio antennas. I have my ham shack. I'm working with a network of other ham radio operators who are part of my prepper group, and we are getting ready for when the crap hits the fan. I believe that we're getting down to the wire here. I believe that 2016 is going to be a pivotal year. I'm predicting that things may flow fairly smoothly up until the election. They always try to keep things looking good up when you're approaching election. That's because the criminals that are in power want to stay in power, and they know that if people get too dissatisfied, they're going to throw them all out of power. That is the reason that they are so afraid of people like Donald Trump, and that's why the establishment is doing their best to keep their establishment cronies in office, because they're scared. They're getting really scared. They're afraid of Donald Trump, and they're more importantly, they're afraid of the people who are supporting Donald Trump. And I'm not supporting Donald Trump. I think he has a lot going for him only because of the fact that the establishment is so against him. And the fact that the establishment is against him tells me that he's doing something right. Remember Ron Paul, the establishment, and Ron Paul's biggest enemy was his own party, the Republican Party. Ron Paul was their best chance for the presidency. And the people who destroyed Ron Paul's chances was his own party, the Republican Party. And it's the Republican Party that is trying to destroy Donald Trump. And for those out there who think that that you should vote for the lesser of two evils, I'm telling you, the lesser of two evils is still evil. The Republican Party is almost as bad as the Democratic Party when it comes to evil. That is why you have to protect yourself. I believe, as I said, they may wait until after the election. They kind of try to hold things off as best they can until after the election. And I think after the election, all crap's going to hit the fan. I believe that 2016 and 2017 are going to be the years when the crap hits the fan. I think this is going to be with us for years to come. I think we're going to be in a very bad situation here for years to come. I think they're going to take us to war. Gerald Celente has been saying for years, when all else fails, they take you to war. And the reason for that is the criminals in charge have to have a scapegoat. They do not want the people to realize that they are responsible for this mess. The people would rise up, overthrow them, hang them, tar and feather them, whatever. So what they will do is they will produce a scapegoat. They will do this through false flags, like they always do. I mean, that is their modem of operation, false flags. I believe they're going to start a war. I believe this one could be a world war. I believe it could involve nuclear weapons, something that's really going to get the Americans' attention off of the real criminals. And they're going to say, this is the people out here, these criminals out here, Russians, Chinese, North Koreans, whoever it might be, these are the people who are responsible for the predicament that you're in. And Americans, historically, history shows us what they're going to do is they're going to put their flags out there. They're going to say, support the troops, and they're going to be behind this war. I'm telling you this now because when all this happens, you will look back to people like me who are warning you that the criminals are the criminals in our own government. And look at what they've done over the years, establishing false flags, giving us enemies to take the attention off of them. Never forget who the real criminals are. But that's another topic. We're not going to go down that line further. I want to get back to the topic of this video. The topic of this video is one of the most important topics, I believe, that I've ever talked to you about. And that topic is about money. Now, if you've watched my videos before, you know I've done videos on silver. I did a video on sterling silver. I've done videos on precious metals, how important it is to have precious metals to protect yourself from a declining dollar. I don't need to rehash all of that. There are a lot of videos out there on the collapsing dollar and precious metals and the reason you should own precious metals. So I'm not going to rehash all of that. What I'm going to emphasize here is what are we going to use for money when the economic collapse occurs? Now, I don't know what they're going to do with the dollar. I believe the dollar is going to be destroyed. I think it's going to be replaced with a global currency. I don't know if that's going to be another fiat currency, not backed by gold and silver. I suspect it will be because fiat currencies keep the criminals in control. They have no control over gold and silver. That is controlled by the marketplace. They do have the control over fiat money. So if they can dupe the people into accepting fiat money again, that's the way they're going to go. In the meantime, what you need to do to protect your wealth is you need to have gold and silver, and you need to have it in your possession. Don't trust it. It held in a bank. Don't trust it held by some of these companies that hold your gold and silver for you. If you want to do some of your money, depending on how much money you have, I know a lot of people right now don't have very much money because of the economic mess that we're in. Some people do have money. My audience will extend over a wide variety of people. If you do have a lot of money, you might want to invest in certain other things, but you need to make sure that you do have a good percentage of your wealth in precious metals that you have in your own possession that you keep secret. Now, I believe that at some point when everything falls apart, we're going to be doing a lot of barter. Out here in the country, I know people who raise chickens, eggs, goats, produce goat's milk, cow's milk, meat. There's a lot of cattle out here. You can buy a quarter of a cow and put it in your freezer. There's people producing a lot of their own food out here. All right, if the dollar becomes worthless for a period of time, or if we do not have a currency for a period of time, there's going to be barter. There is already barter going on out here. We haven't set up our chicken coop yet. We haven't gotten our chickens yet. We do have our rabbits established. We're just working on one thing at a time right now. Right now, I am buying our eggs from a neighbor here. And there are a lot of people out here who sell eggs. My neighbor told me, without me even mentioning it, my neighbor told me that he would accept silver for his eggs. Now, right now, he's accepting dollars, and dollars are what I'm paying him right now. But trust me, these people, these rural people out here, they understand barter. I'm growing a lot of vegetables. I grow more vegetables than he grows. I don't have a lot right now, but as I said, I'm getting my garden established right now, and I will have vegetables. I have no doubt that before this spring and summer and fall is over with, I will be exchanging some of my vegetables with this fella for his eggs. I've also bought raw goat's milk from him. People out here understand barter, and we're going to be doing a lot of barter. The best thing to barter with is gold and silver coins. Everybody knows what their value is. Now, this fella that I'm talking about who produces eggs, he may need something that I have. I may produce vegetables. He may need my vegetables, and I need his eggs, so we can trade eggs for vegetables. All right, what happens though if he wants some of my vegetables and I don't need eggs? Because I am going to get my own chickens and start producing my own eggs. What if he grows his own vegetables and grows the same thing that I'm growing, and we don't actually have anything that we can trade directly with each other? That is where the concept of money comes in. Because money is a form of barter, especially precious metals. That's how money developed. All right, if he has eggs and he doesn't need anything else that I have, I know that he will take my silver. Vice versa, if I have something that he wants and I don't need his eggs, I will take his silver. This silver and gold are going to be the medium of exchange. I want all of you preppers out there to get ready for that. All right, the way you get ready for that is not by storing up a bunch of 1 ounce gold coins. They will be far too valuable. You may use a gold coin to barter or to buy property. You may buy a house. You may buy someone's land with it. You're not gonna buy eggs with a gold coin because the other person is not going to easily be able to make change. What you're gonna want to do is you're going to want to have silver. Gold is a great way to store large amounts of wealth because it doesn't take up a lot of space. It's easier to hide. Silver is bulkier. To have the same amount of money in silver that you would have in gold, silver by comparison is a lot bulkier. But you can use smaller denominations of money when you're bartering with silver. So, I think any form of easily recognizable silver is going to be good for barter. But it needs to be easily recognizable. I don't think sterling silver is going to be as easy to barter with. Yes, we know sterling silver is 0.925 silver. You can weigh it, you can do the calculations. All right, but sterling silver is not as convenient. For one thing, what if it's not marked properly? Or what if it's not marked in a way that the other person recognizes? Or what if the other person just is not as familiar with sterling silver as you are? Yes, I think you can find someone who will take your sterling silver. I don't think it'll be as easy to barter with your neighbors using sterling silver as it will be if you use established forms like these. And that is coins that people recognize. Now, what people also will recognize is they will recognize a 1 ounce silver round or 1 ounce silver bar. Here's a 1 ounce silver round. I think these are spendable just as easily as the coins are. Because it says on it 0.999 fine silver, 1 troy ounce. There it is right there, 1 ounce, 0.999 fine silver. People know what these are. It doesn't matter if it's in a coin form, or that's not a coin, this is actually a round. A coin was originally made for money. This wasn't really made for money. This is called a bullion coin. All right, so it's called a round. Whether it's round or whether it's a bar makes no difference at all. It's marked 1 ounce, 0.999 fine silver. People know what this is worth, because if you know what 1 ounce of silver is worth, that's what this is worth. All right, I think another very convenient way is old U.S. coins. These are abundant half dollar coins, quarters, dimes. All right, all the U.S. silver coins minted prior to 1965, that means those dated 1964 and earlier, are made of 90% silver. And by the way, Canadian coins were made of 80% silver, I think up until 1968. You have to check on that. I'm not really absolutely sure. But Canadian coins, because it's a standard amount of silver in all their coins, 80%. Yes, it's not as much silver as in this. It would take a little bit more of them to equal these 90% coins, but they're still silver and they'll spin just as easily. More easily in Canada, because Canadians will know what they are. In America, in the United States, we're not as familiar with Canadian coinage. But there's a lot of this old U.S. coins around. 1964 and earlier, these are 90% silver. They contain approximately 0.72 troy ounces of silver per $1 face value. Okay, this is $1 face value. This is 2 50-cent pieces. All right, a silver dollar is $1 face value. 4 silver quarters is $1 face value. 10 silver dimes is $1 face value. So 10 silver dimes are worth 2 50-cent pieces, are worth 4 quarters. All right, you see how convenient that is to do your calculations? It's the same amount of silver in all of them, depending on their face value. So if you need to make change, or you need to deal with small amounts of money, have quarters, have dimes, have half dollars. These are going to be your real money. It's going to be hard to buy eggs with a gold coin. Here, by the way, I just happened to find a Canadian dime. Again, I said it's 80%. I don't know how that got in this bag. It's 80% silver. Now, These are what I recommend that you buy. Now, it's perfectly fine to buy silver rounds and silver bars, but I recommend that you buy these. The reason for that is it costs money to mint coins. In other words, to put silver into coins. This has already been paid for. It was paid for with your tax dollars back when these were first minted. So you can buy these for close to the silver value. Now right now, if someone wants to go out and make a silver round, they have to take silver, melt it down, go through the process of making a silver round. So you're gonna pay a little bit more than what the silver is actually worth, and that's called a premium. And that's perfectly fine, but you want to buy the silver, not the premium, because when you sell your silver, you are not going to get the premium, or at least not much of it. So buy the metal, not the premium. And that's the thing about these old coins, is the premium has already been paid for, and you can get these for very close. And while I'm on that subject, other forms of precious metals that are out there, make sure you are buying the metal. I've seen these little credit cards that have a small amount of gold in them, like one tenth of a gram of gold. I've seen this paper money that has actually one tenth of a gram of gold. All right, look up the price of gold. Convert that from the price of gold is given in troy ounces. Convert those troy ounces to grams. Do the calculations. You can figure these formulas out. They're easy. Look it up. Do the calculations and figure out what 1 gram of gold is worth, and figure out what 1/10 of a gram of gold is, and whatever you're thinking about buying there. All right. And look at how much you're paying. You should not be paying if 1/10 of a gram, and I'm just going to make these numbers up, and if 1/10 of a gram of gold is worth $10, you don't want to be paying $50 for it. You don't even want to be paying $20 for it. You don't even want to be paying maybe you pay a little bit more than $10, maybe $11 or so. I wouldn't want to pay more than $11. So don't buy $10 worth of gold and pay more than $11 for it. Do the calculations. Buy the metal, not the premium. Because when it comes time to sell that, what you're gonna do, you know, if you have a 1/10 gram of gold and you paid $50 for it and it's only worth 10 when you go to spend it, guess what you're gonna get for it? You're gonna get $10 for it. You're gonna lose $40. When you wanna go ahead and put that full $50 into the metal so that you can get it back. Don't fall for that. Buy real money. My preference is these old US coins. Now I want to talk about a special coin, and that's the 50 cent piece or the Kennedy half dollar. I want you to be familiar with this coin too. Now Kennedy was assassinated in 1963. And just as a little side note here, the reason Kennedy was murdered was he was murdered because he came out against the Federal Reserve. He was going to get rid of the Federal Reserve. All right, and they had him killed for it. That right there should let you know who the enemy is, okay? The enemy is the bankers, and it is our government officials who are controlled by the bankers, and that pretty much is all of them. But anyway, Kennedy was figured out, why are we paying the Federal Reserve? Why are we making this money and then we're paying interest on it to the Federal Reserve? We could just make our own money and not pay anybody interest on it. Well, of course, duh, right, that makes a lot of sense, right? If you look at 1963 dollar bills, you will find there are two kinds of 1963 dollar bills. One kind has Federal Reserve note on the top, and the other one has United States bank note at the top. Other than that, the dollar bills look exactly the same. Federal Reserve note, United States bank note. Those United States bank notes were the ones that Kennedy authorized bypassing the Federal Reserve. You can find those bills out there. Look in, go to a coin collecting shop where they sell paper money. People collect paper money too. and ask for $1963, and you'll see what I'm talking about. That, practically to me, that's proof right there why they killed Kennedy. He took the Federal Reserve note off the top and put on the United States bank note, cutting out the Federal Reserve. Well, you saw what happened to Kennedy. Anyway, they killed Kennedy in 1963, and in 1964, they came out with, they changed the half dollar in his honor. And so the first year of the Kennedy coin was 1964. That happened to be the last year that our silver was 90% was 90% silver. So 1964 Kennedy half dollars are unique from any other Kennedy half dollars in that they are 90% silver. All right, those were the last, 1964 again was the last year that our money was 90% silver. All right, 1965 and onward, quarters and dimes were clad coins. They had no silver in them at all. They're made of copper and nickel. They still looked fairly similar, but they had no silver in them at all. What they did do, though, they continued putting silver in the Kennedy half dollars for another few years, but instead of 90%, they made them 40% silver. So the 64 Kennedy half dollars are 90% silver, 65, 66, 67, 68, 69, and 70 are 40% silver. All right, the reason I mention these is because these are still traded as bullion coins. You will see these, they are good money. You do have to make the proper calculations. They're not 90%, they're 40%. Look it up and see how much silver's in there. I don't remember right off the top of my head, but you go to bullion shops to buy bullion. All right, if you go in there and say, I want to buy some 90% silver coins, or oh, we're out of those, which they're going to be soon as people catch on and start buying more of these. But we've got some of these 40% Kennedys. Bomb. They're good. All right, they've been used for bullion coins ever since they've come out. They will always be recognized as bullion coins. You can spend these as money. They're not worth as much as a 90%, but they are still good money. A 1970 Kennedy half dollar was not minted for circulation. The only ones in 1970, right here. The only ones in 1970 minted were in mint sets. So the mintage of those is very small. You won't see very many of those. There were a lot of, that's 72. Here's 70. All right, 70. All right, there are a lot of 69, a lot of 68, 67, and 65, and lots and lots of 64s. You do need to make a distinction between 64 and 65 through 70. All right, because they're not the same amount, but they're all still good coins. Now, they're good sources of silver. Now, in 1971, right here, they continued minting the Kennedy half dollars, but they took out all silver. They were the nickel copper coins that, just like the quarters and dimes, already were since 1965. All right, so from 1971 on, and all of these coins, 1971, 72, 73, etc., all the Kennedy coins up to the present day, these were all copper nickel coins, just like our quarters and dimes are now. They are worth the same as paper money. Two of these is worth one paper dollar bill. Don't invest in these. Unless you're just like me, you like to collect some coins like this, but do not buy them for the silver content because they contain no silver. 64 is a very good coin to buy because there are lots and lots and lots and lots of them out there, and they're circulating right now as bullion coins. People who buy silver bullion are buying those. They're not just buying silver rounds and silver bars. They're buying also rolls and bags and huge amounts of 64 Kennedys. They're also buying bags of the 40% Kennedys. Okay, so I just wanted to mention the Kennedy half dollars because they are unique. Our dimes and our quarters were 90% up until they took silver out, and then they had no silver in them after that. The Kennedy half dollar was 90% up and through 1964, just like the quarters and the dimes. And from 65 through 70, they are 40% silver. They are still good. What I recommend you do, I know right now a lot of people have lost their jobs. A lot of people are in dire financial situations. So everybody's different. Depending on what you're able to do, I recommend that any extra money that you have, you start buying these coins. In particular, what I would buy is I would buy the circulated United States silver coins. They've been around for literally for centuries, and they're everybody recognizes them. Or for the new people who just are learning about this thing, if they don't recognize them immediately, it won't take them very long to learn. When we start using this as money, as a means of exchange, as barter, people are going to recognize these 90% U.S. coins. People are going to learn very quickly. Most people already know what they are. All right, the ones who don't are going to learn very quickly. Stock up on your 90% silver coins. Those of you who live in Canada, if you want to stock up on your coins, your 80% silver coins, that's perfectly fine. A lot of Canadians actually stock up on old U.S. coins, 90% U.S. coins. All right, if you go to your coin and bullion dealer and they're out of these coins, don't hesitate to buy rounds and bars. Those are good too. It's just that when you buy a round or a bar, you're going to probably pay a little bit more of a premium, because you're going to be paying the person who bought that paid a little bit of a premium because it costs money to put that silver into that round, and they're going to pass that premium on to you. All right, so say if silver is $15 an ounce, you're not going to buy a 1 ounce silver round for $15. You're probably going to pay more like $17, $19. You want to keep that to a minimum. There are people out there who will charge you too much for these. All right, make sure that you know what you're buying and know what it's worth. Now here in St. Louis, we have a dealer called Scotsman Coins. Their website is scoins.com. I'm not affiliated with them at all, other than the fact that I have been one of their customers for years. They know me. If you go in there and talk to anybody in Scotsman's Coin, or if you contact them by email, tell them Doc sent you. And not all of them in there, they have a large staff, and not all of them know me, but there are a few people in there that I do business with, and they will know me, and you just tell them Doc sent you, and they'll know exactly who you're talking about. But that doesn't matter. You're not going to get a special deal because she said Doc sent me. I don't get anything from them at all. I have no financial relationship with them. I recommend them because I've been dealing with them for years, and they are very, very, very respectable people. I have not only bought from them, but I've also sold coins when I needed to divest myself of gold or silver, or if I had silver and I needed to convert it to gold, or I actually took my sterling silver. If you remember from my other video that I bought a lot of sterling silver, well, when I moved out here, I wanted to downsize. All right, for one thing, I have a smaller house out here, and I didn't want to move a lot of stuff. I took all my sterling silver to a Scotsman's Coin and converted it all into rounds, silver rounds, and silver coins. Now, I had to have some money because I needed money to move, and so I'm not saying that I converted all of it into silver rounds. Unfortunately, I had to just sell some of it in order to have money to move and to buy our property out here and everything. And the reason I'm talking about Scotsman's Coins is because even if you don't live in this area, they have a great website. You can go to scoins.com and look up their price sheets. If you want to do a comparison with your local dealer, look up their price sheets and see what they are selling 90% U.S. coins for, or bars, or rounds, or gold, or silver, platinum, whatever. It's all on the price sheets. All right, it changes every single day depending on the spot price of the precious metals. So they print out these price sheets every single day. Go on the website, print out a price sheet, take that to your local bullion dealer, ask him how much he will sell you these 90% circulated United States coins for, and look at your price sheet and say, well, you know, how come your price is like so much ridiculously higher than this price here from this other dealer? All right, make sure you have a current price sheet because this price does change on a daily basis. But that will just give you some comparison so that you will not go out there and pay too much. Remember, one of the most important things that you can get from this video is buy the metal. Pay for the metal. Do not pay for the premium. You won't get your premium back. Buy the metal, not the premium. So, and when you're buying gold and silver, look and do the calculation. When you buy these little credit cards that have a tenth of a gram of gold in them, do the calculation, find out exactly what a tenth of gold is worth, and then how much are you paying for that credit card there, or that paper money that's got gold embedded in it. All right, and if you're paying more than, if you're paying a lot more, now you, again, you're gonna have to pay a little bit of a premium because it costs money to put it in that form. But if you're paying like twice the price of what that gold is worth, pass on it. You're throwing your money away. You're going to need every dime, and you're going to need to put every dime into the precious metals. Stock up on precious metals here real soon. I believe we're going to be using these for money. I think you're going to need it. I think you're going to need to have it in your possession. All right, now what happens if you don't, if you're afraid of keeping these in your home? All right, I don't recommend you keep it in a safety deposit box. The government has come into banks and confiscated people's wealth from safety deposit boxes, and I think they'll probably do that again. You need to keep it secret. One way I heard one person suggested on a video that I watched on YouTube, I thought was a great, great idea, and that is, what he did was he went and got one of these storage facilities, you know, where you can store furniture or whatever you wanted to store, you know, where you get one of these storage containers or you rent one of these storage bins and you get a key to it and you can go in and put things in it, take things out as you want to. All right, take your gold and silver, buy a safe, put it in the safe, lock the safe, put the safe in the back of your storage facility, and then fill the rest with junk furniture. All right, and then keep that a secret. And if anybody does break into your storage facility, they're just gonna see a bunch of junk, old mattresses, old couches, whatever. And they're not going to pull all that stuff out unless they know or if they suspect you're hiding something of value in there. All right, they're going to open that up and they're going to say, well, this is just a bunch of furniture. Yeah, oh, you know what? I could use a chair. I might take that chair. But they're not going to empty everything out. All right, they're going to go through. If this does happen, these places are pretty well locked up, pretty well protected, and they're guarded and they're watched with video cameras. I think they're safe. But just as an extra layer of safety, and so you don't have to keep this stuff actually in your home where it could be dangerous or where it could be stolen, rent one of these facilities, put your money in a safe, put the safe in the back, anything else of value that you want to keep there, put some paperwork in there in case your house burns down, you make copies of your paperwork, whatever you want to keep in a safe, put that in the back, cover it with old mattresses and couches and chairs and things like that, and you're good. This is Survival Doc reminding you, be prepared or be prepared to be fleeced.